Hey everybody, it is Cinnamon Cooney, your art sherpa, and today we're going to be painting this gorgeous fall fantasy with an owl and fall leaves and branches twisting around, creating this wonderful keyhole frame into a fantasy magical forest. I mean, we're doing the things. Now, this is going to be an acrylic lesson on an 8x8 surface. I am going to explain it step by step. I'm explaining the techniques, I'm explaining the color mixes, I'm explaining the colors, we'll talk exchanges, and to help me do all that awesomeness is my husband, John.
Hello.
He helps me bring these really wonderful free step-by-step lessons to you guys by making sure that you can get zoomed in on the action, you can see the mixes, that really that the cameras turn on, that all the stuff happens. I see that we've got some Veronica coming from Alaska. We got Judy coming in, and Isha, and Kelly. So I see people coming in. I see Ollie and Raheel and Ashley Welch and the Gray Penguin. Guys, there is a contest going on right now. There is a giveaway. Moderators will be dropping the links. So if you want to participate, that Beck Milford said 378 stars. So I got to say thank you to that.
Oh my gosh.
That is wonderful. And let's start out, because this whole thing of art is really about having some grateful art space. And let's just think about for just 2 seconds as we begin our painting, and I'll write mine on my surface. You can choose to or not on yours. I'm going to be using watercolor pencil. What right now, not politics, what right now is giving you peace of mind, well-being? What is your self-care? I'm going to say that mine, weirdly, was sticking butterflies in my hair. I'm feeling like I can... decorate my soul. Really made me happy this morning as things were getting weird and challenging, you know.
You have accessorized yourself.
I've accessorized. I have my little owl on. I've got my stuff, and that felt really good. And I'm using a watercolor pencil here. Thank you. Colleen Marie has the contest link, or the moderators will have it. If you see what the wrench is, they'll be dropping that. All you've got to do is answer the questions and be here when we announce the winner on the giveaway. Just a couple heads up on that.
There's questions.
Give us your name online on the platform. Like, sometimes we don't use our real names on there, on that form, and your real name. It will ask you for an email, and that's just so we can contact you, and we will pick a random winner during the show towards the end. And if you're here when we call your name, we'll send you a brush, as long as you have mail, places that receive mail in this kind of way. And, you know, anywhere in the world, we're pretty cool about it. Yep. It'll be nice. And Katie says, I look gorgeous, all in caps. And I have to take that. And Amy is celebrating my butterflies. That's been like this thing for me lately. I'm going to get some more of these butterflies. So this owl today, I am excited. It's going to be an easy start, my friends, because we're going to start out with some burnt umber. The most common underpainting color that you can use. It actually really is. Burnt umber or gray are like the most commons that you will see used in underpainting.
Is it burnt umber's more red and raw umber's more blue?
No, burnt umber is a deeper color. It's biased more towards the black, and the raw umber actually goes more yellow.
Yellow. Oh, interesting.
Yeah. Burnt raw sienna also more yellow.
So interesting, raws are more yellow, and
isn't that weird?
Burnts are darker.
Deeper, darker, and bias into a richer red or cooler
space.
Don't
burn my umber.
Don't burn it. It's like burning your biscuits, right? Did you burn the biscuits? So to paint these in, Laura says, I wish I had acrylic paints at home. Oh, man, Laura, I wish you did too. Tomorrow is a watercolor, though. Tomorrow is the last day of grateful art. Not that we're not grateful. We're going to paint the whole surface burnt umber. And apparently I'm going to do it with the smallest brush. This is such a small brush. This is a number 20 ruby satin. And it is, it's all kinds of hot mess. Like the ferrules all coming loose. I'm like, really, I picked a humdinger here today. I'll glue it on later.
It's the glue.
Yeah, it's the glue.
It's going to
need it
because
it's entirely possible. You can kind of see that it's entirely possible the ferrule will come loose during the painting.
Eh.
Eh. happens.
Modern glues.
If it happens to your brushes that you buy, you return them. And I wouldn't even say it's the modern glues. I would say there are certain, it's choices.
It is. It's choices.
Choices. And
compounds and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Being really on top of it. All right. That's all it takes, my friends, is a brown background. Anyways, if this ever happens to you and you just want to spit it back down, you can use a little CA glue in here if you don't want to return it and stabilize the handle. Mm-hmm. And then you're good as new.
Yeah, if you leave it in water and it swells and does that kind of stuff, yeah, you can just put more glue in there.
And let's be honest, sometimes you didn't even leave it in water, right? Yeah.
No, sometimes it's just like...
not well seated when it was made. And so if you want to keep it and you don't want to return it, or... you know, you didn't damage it. Whatever it is, you want to keep it, glue it.
Mm-hmm.
Glue it. I'm going to dry this.
Okay. So when you're drying your surface, of course, make sure you thoroughly dry. And the reason why you thoroughly dry is so that you don't forget to hit the subscribe button. Because if you hit the subscribe button, then you can be like part of our awesome family. And then if you hit the bell next to it, then you can click all, and then you can get notifications when we go live. But... back to that that ham-fisted segue, you should dry your paint surface thoroughly with low heat, because low heat, heat isn't really good for your paint. It's just not in general. And you want to thoroughly dry it so that when you get to your next layer, like if you're drawing anything on there, you don't want the chalk to pick up any of the softened paint. Again, don't use heat because it softens the paint. And so just make sure it's like thoroughly dry.
Thoroughly dry, so you can sketch on it. I got a couple things.
You did?
Angela Nolan says she is here for life for the very first time. So welcome, Angela Nolan.
Live.
And...
no, I'm just saying we're live.
Live. Okay, I thought you were going to say, sometimes John says really cool and deep things, and I never want to stop him from doing that. And no. Twinette Atkins says she has some brushes and that their ferrules fall off all the time. Share with everyone what the brand of those brushes are, because sometimes if we talk to each other as consumers, we can kind of get a sense of things that are working really well and things that are not. Mm. And that's always a good idea. Nope, I have the wrong pencil.
No, I was just mentioning not to use heat and to make sure it's thoroughly dry so you don't gum up your pencil or chalk.
Well, things are super true. So what it is, what John's talking about, is acrylic is very temperature sensitive. And when it's warm, it's softer. It's more pliable. Whether the painting has been dry a long time or the paint is very fresh, that heat effect or the cold effect on acrylic, because it's plastic, is always relevant. So when you're sketching into it or doing stuff where it might press into it, you do want it to be cool and you want it to be dry. Heat talk. TikTok is wonderful. All right. So I'm going to take a chalk pencil. This is a General's chalk pencil. And I just want to sketch in a little bit of placement of everything, so I know where stuff is. And that way, as I'm painting in, I am not taking away stuff that I feel like I would really want to see. The first thing that I'm going to do is make a loose circle. And the reason it doesn't have to be a really accurate circle is because these are tree branches that are bending around. And so everything inside that, right, will not have to be like perfect, because they're going to be winding and doing stuff. Quinette says Royal and Lang Nickel. That answer does not surprise me. Things I like about Royal and Lang Nickel is the plastic handles and the fact that they will sometimes have these rubber grips. Right? You see that there? It's a soft rubber grip. The Royal and Lang Nickel. And I really like that about the company, especially if people are having grip issues and stuff like that for hand pain and everything. They do have a ferrule issue. In fact, this one is loose. For sure. They have a ferrule issue. Okay, let's place in where we think our tree house is going to be. So we know we've got a little tree here, and it's got some little roots coming forward. And it has a window. We'll just loosely sketch that in right now. This isn't a perfect rendering of what we're trying to do. We just want to know where objects are. Now, you're sitting there going, this is great, but I don't draw a stick figure. No worries, because we have a traceable, and I have a video on how to use it. Actually, two videos on how to use them. You can absolutely do that. There are apps. There's all kinds of ways to get the traceables on your surface, and it's not cheating. And that's important to know. Lori says, I have some brushes, not sure the brand, that I just love, but the ferrules get loose sometimes, probably from neglect. I tighten them with my jewelry making tools. Lori, that is some arty, crafty stuff and a good way of doing it. You can re-crimp a ferrule. You can reseat a ferrule. It's super, super doable. I don't really ever throw out a brush, even when the bristles are like, because then it becomes cloud texture brushes. Brushes are forever, even when they're like almost sticks. Actually, I've seen people take brushes that were sticks and tape the sticks together so they could have a long Monet-style brush. Samantha says, my aunt says if you paint with acrylic over a certain temperature, that can even bubble. And I will add to what your aunt said. If your acrylic is bubbling, you are releasing off gases that are dangerous to your health.
That's acrylic very bad.
Should not be heated.
No.
Not even with like a heat gun. It's hair dryer kind of. If you put it in your dryer to set, you shouldn't be in the room with your dryer. Because that, even that temperature is formaldehyde. Something people often don't know. It's safe. It's just not safe on fire. Which firemen will tell you there are many things that are not.
Do not.
I'm going to come up to, if you imagine that this is in half, about the halfway mark at the top, I'm going to make a little mushroom top. It's got sort of a slim, we're going to see a lot of its underside is what it is. And you're going to bring this under and curve that. When we have a mushroom, we like to curve it. Do a counter curve for the stem and curve back out. And I have two lines. They're going to be parallel and they're going to curve. They're going to kind of come together and they are going to kind of express the stem. That's not bad. And then what's wonderful, our owl, initially to put him in, he's just almost like a little thumb shape. Which, yes, we're going to be more specific with him later. You know, but really he's going to take up this space and he's got the little sort of baby Yoda effect, I feel. Of course, I've been watching The Mandalorian, so bear with me.
I've been watching a bunch of Mandalorian parodies.
Have you?
Which have been satisfying.
There are no parodies of The Mandalorian. The Mandalorian must be taken seriously at all times. All times, sir.
You know, where they redub them with other voice actors.
All right. So don't forget to enter the contest if you'd like a chance to win a free win a brush from us. An Art Sherpa number 8 Cat's Tongue. It's this brush right here. Fantastic brush, amazing for acrylic paint, very tight ferrule. You can enter, but you've got to be here to win. I'm going to actually paint the next part of this painting with that. Let's start out with the background. Interestingly enough, I'm going to put out some phthalo blue, and I've got my burnt umber here, and I'm going to put out some titanium white. If I can find its little location. You can see all the colors in the description below before the event or on our website, or often as we announce things, we'll like let you guys know. We did an email when this event began because we knew we were going to be painting every day live with all the materials and all the traceables and the references. So if you're signed up on our newsletter, check your spam box if you didn't see it because, you know, maybe you missed it. Or if you'd like to be signed up for that, definitely get signed up for that. I'm going to take my number 8 cat's tongue. I'm going to dip it in my water. I'm going to mix a little of my blue into my burnt umber.
Hold on, let me move the picture.
And then I'm going to add some white. And I'm going to just stroke down. And notice that it's streaky. This wonderful little sky effect that we've got. This is totally what we mean by loosely mixed. I'm not thoroughly incorporating these two paints together. I'm allowing them to be a little marbled and to mix somewhat on the canvas. So that is burnt umber, phthalo blue, and titanium white. Now I'm going to paint out a little bit of what I sketched. That's because it's real easy for me to put back.
What kind of paint are you using today?
I am using Sennelier, I am using Holbein, and I am using Golden and Artist Loft Level 3. Mm-hmm. So, you might say that I have a preference there.
You're painting over the thing you just drew in.
I know, but it makes it easier to do the fan. But. And draw it back again. Here's what. You may not be here now, my friends, but I have to tell you something. Both my mom and I, who are lifelong artists, I am, thanks to my mom, because when you say you want to be an artist in my family, she doesn't go, that's the craziest thing I've ever heard. She goes, oh, good. How are you going to make a living? when you have working artists in your family, it's a rough go. I never worry about having to do a painting again. I never worry, like when something happens in my painting, when my babies would get a Sharpie on my painting, I was like, I'll do it again. When you've been doing this for a while and you have a lot of confidence in your ability to repeat an event, I'm just taking more white and I'm going to streak, as you can see, this sort of light effect coming down.
I like how it streaks out that way.
That's just how we're going to get that little streaky effect. We like it. We do. We like it very, very, very much. So that's a pretty good one. I'm going to dry this real fast. I will kind of paint, sketch back in everything else.
Yeah, paint, just sketch it. Okay, so we'll look back over here. Whoosh, cross zoom. Yeah. Don't forget to go check out our website, theartsherpa.com. We got all kinds of cool stuff out there, like a store. We can go to the store and check that out there. We sell some cool stuff in there. We got no cool stuff that's going in there. If you want to get text notifications, you can just send a message to the phone number 33222, and that message is The Yard Sherpa. And if you send that message, well then.
We'll tell you that we're live if we have enough text left.
That's true.
We'll let you know. Miranda Jones says she hopes we're doing well, and absolutely, we're doing really good, and thank you for asking. Artsy Sister, hi everyone, how do we enter to win the brush? The moderators are dropping the link. You just go fill out the form, and we're going to randomly pick somebody. You got to be here when we announce it.
Just fill the form.
And I just also want to say thank you to, I saw this earlier, and I don't know where it went, to Susan Jones. Love your videos. Thank you, Susan.
Thank you.
Raheel's like, it's midnight. I'm too sleepy.
Well, Raheel, we're glad you're hanging out with us.
I'm just fixing any little areas that I feel might need more paint for when I weave the trees through.
When you weave the trees.
Yeah, when I weave the trees through, because you're going to weave some trees through. So you always got to take that moment. Now I'm going to add some black in my palette. Moment I add some black in black or something.
Good AC/DC song.
Uh-huh. But like a bar of it. Not like all of it, just a bar. There it is. There's some black. This one happens to be carbon black. You can use Mars black. This is just what comes in that, you know, that set of Artist Loft paints that I love so much that I make a bunch of videos. It's like six paints, and I made a bunch of videos of all the things you could paint with just those six paints. But that's their black. It's in exchange for Mars Black. I'm going to take a little of my burnt umber and my Mars Black and burn my umber more. It's like burn my biscuits.
Don't do it.
Burn my biscuits. I'm going to just start the tree. And yes, I will be putting my window back in. I don't mind doing this. I like to let you guys know where things are placed. The reason I don't mind doing it is because it's real easy for me to find it again.
Pop art. You've done some stuff that's really surprisingly teaches the mechanics, if you will, of pop art using very strange things. Like what comes to mind is the Pop Art Cow, which was really fun, and I liked it. And also the Pop Art Cat, that one was good. And also, when you did the guy who was smoking a pipe on the
block. Expressive Man.
Expressive Man.
This is why you guys title my paintings.
So, if you're interested in some pop art, If
put
you go
out
to,
some bird sienna, my friends.
If you go to thearchsherpa.com and click on videos, there's a little search bar, and you can just type in those videos, and it will. You can find it. Pop art. We have a bunch of them in there. But yeah, it's some cool stuff.
He's not wrong. We're going to put out some cad red and some yellow. And I'll go over these colors in just a second. Just for a minute, we don't need any green yet, so we're just getting out what we need. This is a strategy when you're painting and you're trying to make sure that you're you save money on your painting. Sometimes putting the paint out when you need it and not before can be very helpful. Rosemary's like, did I hear that you might move out of Texas? Rosemary, we moved out of Texas. We're in Pennsylvania now.
Yep.
Whoop. 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 We got snow and bears and wild turkeys and deer. So basically home, except there's now bears.
Okay. So what I would say is they're not turkeys. They're velociturkeys.
Mm-hmm.
They're just like.
You are not wrong, sir.
They're 6 foot tall and angry. And when they run, they're fast.
Tracy wants to know what we're painting. And if you look behind my head, Tracy, you'll see a reference picture. Now, you can get this from us, the full image, so you can print it out. Use as your own reference. I do highly recommend that. But that is what we're doing today. We're painting this fabulous fantasy painting. I think you're going to love it. And then Patricia says she never gets to catch us live, and she's so happy to be here, and thank you for doing what we do. We're so happy to do it. What colors do we have out now? We have cad yellow medium. What if you didn't have cad yellow medium? Well, you could use Hansa yellow or primary yellow, and many other yellows, quite often. Azo yellow. You just want a medium yellow that is kind of a bright, sunny yellow. I've got cad red medium. If you didn't have that, you could use naphthol red medium or pyrrole red. You would be okay. Burnt sienna, phthalo blue, not burnt sienna, burnt umber, phthalo blue, burnt sienna, yellow ochre, and titanium white. That's where we're at right now. I'm going to come in here, and we're going to start with a little mix, a loose mix of our burnt sienna and our yellow ochre, and we're going to come from the bottom, if you think about it, it's about this far up on the surface, and we're going to kind of negative space paint here. We're going to add a root. But we're doing that by painting out away what isn't tree, and we're going to make it brown. And how we're going to get that is, you notice my brush, everything is sort of loosely mixed and loaded on the toe of the brush. That's the edge here. And this paint is still a little bit wet, and we're going to brush back and forth in a very rough painterly motion. You can see I'm just dashing. And that technique is done.
Mm-hmm.
The ground forest floor. And because we're using these colors, they'll feel very fall. And in this painting right now, the burnt sienna is almost a red. Now, will we add fall leaves to this? Of course we will. We would totally do that. But we're wanting to imply a nice little forest floor here. And we can even come back a little bit behind here and kind of even add a hint of it from behind our mushroom. See how we got a little hint of that behind the mushroom? And that kind of creates the root that you can now see there. The root is painted by painting away. So that's a negative painting, right? You're painting the negative space. The space isn't the object. By painting that, you create the space in which the object exists. Kind of a fun thing to do. Let's add some bark. I'm going to keep using this brush. So our light source, as you can guess, is right here. And that means this part of the tree will be lighter. I'm on the toe of my cat's tongue. And I'm just showing you this brush because this is the brush that you can win today.
Ooh.
I'm going to go ahead, and you can see I'm just lightly brushing. And this dry brushing is creating a bark effect. There are so many ways to paint bark. You guys can't even. The ways of bark painting are many. And we're just coming lightly here. Rough bark. And bark really works in any of the ways we do it, whether we sponge paint it or we're using a hog bristle brush, however we're painting it. It is about having dark values, rough surfaces, rough marks, right? These marks are very rough. and making sure that the values of the paint absolutely go through. And I promise you, bark is more colorful than you think. Very colorful. Now, as we come back towards the back of the tree, and I'm coming back with just more of my burnt umber and a little mix of burnt sienna, more burnt umber. We're going to have this be a slightly darker value. Yes, we're going to come in and add the window, but we want to show at first this rough. Hear that little scraping noise?
Scrapey, scrape, scrape,
scrape. You can see it there. I'm not putting a lot of pressure on that brush. What happens is, as you can see, sometimes the toe pushes what paint's already in the belly out to the other side, and when you flip the brush, you get different colors. Here's wave double loading.
Double loaded.
Pretty terrific. I'm going to go ahead and get a little blue into my mix. Maybe add a little black and get some white. It's going to create kind of a barky gray. You know how when like wood ages out, weathers? We're going to add a little bit of this to the tree. Very lightly. In a couple of places, randomly. Random. Avoid them patterns. Cheryl King, you are smart. Cheryl tried to enter, but no luck. So that's a Google form. And you'd have to be able to load Google Forms onto your phone. And we are still here to help. You've got plenty of time to get to the entry. Do not worry. Added a little more brown to the mix. And I'm just at, I don't want to take out all the work I've already done. I just want to add some of this. Some. It's like cayenne pepper. Some is wonder. Everybody from Texas, right? Peppers? Some is good. All the pepper can be bad. We all know it from a chili cook-off, do we not? Rahil's like wondering if I'm tired. I don't feel like I'm tired. Maybe my color balance isn't good.
Oh, well, I don't think so.
I don't feel tired.
Your color looks good.
I'm actually pretty excited.
You seem pretty
caffeinated.
I'm working
on our winter event, and I'm thinking of something wild and crazy to do. I don't know if it'll be a good idea or not.
I like it. I think it's a good idea.
Well, you always think all my ideas are good.
But that's why I'm here. We don't do any of the ideas that I think are bad.
No. Well, sometimes we do. Sometimes you indulge me. You're like, I don't really know. I'm going to add a little more here. And you can see I just pull some of that down. But I don't paint out everything I have. I go back into my dark color, and maybe coming from the bottom here, I might create a bit of a shadow value right here in the center of the trees if the tree is sort of folded in. Right? The tree is really a tube. But look at that. We have a nice little barky tree. Barky tree.
Barky tree.
I'm going to add a little, I haven't rinsed my brush. Notice that I just keep going and I don't rinse my brush. I'm going to get a little red into that. Right there. And red. I'm here.
That tree is.
You never knew trees or rocks were so colorful till you did the last 2 days of paintings, right?
Mm-hmm.
I like that. That's pretty good. Oh, I love it. Rovetta says, I just joined. Can you please repeat what you are painting today? So if you look in the corner here, you'll see the reference. We also have it on the event in the group and on the website, so you can print it out if you want to have a printout of it or have it on another device. And so that's the fantasy painting that we're doing today is Mr. Cute Chubby
right
Owl.
This big,
yeah, this one. We're painting this. From my imagination, because I have a digital drawing tablet.
I imagined a thing.
I did. And then I made the thing happen. I'm going to grab some just yellow right now, actually, weirdly, to sketch in the window. But because I'm me, and we all know I can't make a straight line to save my life, I'm going to use my T-square ruler. If you are straight line challenged, as I am, An inexpensive T-square ruler. You don't have to get the architect. Like the one for architects, yes, is in the hundreds of dollars. But they're architects. You want them to be accurate when they make things so your building doesn't fall down. Artists, I don't got to worry about that as much. So I can take the cheap $3 T-square, which is about what you should spend. But it does help me do the following here, which is to create a nice straight line. I'm going to make this line from the 3-centimeter mark to about the 6.5-centimeter mark. And you can see that just gives me that straight little line. And then if I want to come from the sides, it can help me there too. Mm-hmm. Right? I'm going to come up just a little bit. And it's a very light brushing. And I'm using the yellow because I know the window is going to have a lot of it. So why not? And then once I get this in, I can easily work out the shape. But those lines would be hard for me because my hand wouldn't necessarily want to go an angle here, angle there. That is not going to look windowy. I'm so happy. Now we're going to arc over. This is the whatever little magical creature lives in the tree. They went ahead and went for the upgrade on the window. Have that in, and I'm going to start with a little bit, and this is my number 4 round, so that's just a brush that gives me some control. I'm going to take a little bit of my CAD red, mix it into my CAD yellow, and we're going to come out here and start to paint the glow in the window. Glow in the window. Now, if your yellow is very inexpensive and you find it won't paint over the brown and it is just making you miserable, stop. Oh, buy your painting. Oh, thank you, Katie! Katie did a super chat. We appreciate that so much. So I don't even know what to say. Katie's kindness broke my brain, but I'm okay. So if it's really thin and you can't get it to work and you're just like, don't throw the painting away. Dry it with your hair dryer. Let it rest. Paint the window white and then go back to yellow. Mm-hmm. And that'll work anytime your yellow or your colors are just too weak. I started doing that with students when we were doing bright tulips. And we were doing really inexpensive kind of painting party paint.
Yeah.
And you needed to get these bright red colors, paint them white first, let it dry, go over it, and then they wouldn't be struggling. And that is with the cheapest paint on earth. So I know it worked. I'm adding a little more red to it. And you can see the marks are rough. They're just a rough little mark. And that's okay. Mm-hmm. And a little more red. Make those up and down. Isn't that pretty? There we go. Sometimes I might go into my yellow a little more and get a little more yellow. But I haven't rinsed my brush. So in a sense, that mother color is still there, right?
Yeah.
You just come in and make a nice little light. Now, come over here and interestingly enough, get your black into your red. If you did my video of all the ways to make brown, you'll remember that CAD red and black make brown. And that's kind of useful if you don't have brown sometime in your palette. They make a really beautiful brown. But the trick about using the CAD red to make the brown and the black is that I can create the shadow here while still keeping that sense of the glow. Even as I go into more and more black for the corner, it will still have enough red to feel like that. Isn't that great?
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes, you know, you don't want it to come in with a darker black. You don't want it to be brown. You want to go with your red and your black. Sometimes. Not all the time. There are no all the time things in art, you know. There are sometimes things in art. I'm going to take my red, my ultramarine, and I'm going to, not ultramarine, what on earth? Burnt sienna, my friends.
What are you doing?
I don't know. And I'm going to just outline a pane around my window. I'm doing that.
Oh, thank you, Peaches.
Thank you, Peaches. And then a little bit underneath. And these are the support structures. Now, these will show better when you give them the contrasting black line, but we want to get this in first. All right, so we have that in. Now here's how we get it to go. We're going to get our black, We're going to dip a bit of water in there. We're going to get to a nice fluid state, right? Where right now I'm about 2 drops in and I'm mixing and incorporating it through the black. I'm my number 4 round has a good point. Oh, Kay Groffs and 500 stars. Thank you, Kay.
Thank you, Kay.
So I'm going to come here and just go very lightly around. This is just a dark, this is where the window is set into the tree, right? And it would be, the crease would be very much in shadow. Because you know molding. I might come in on the inside a little bit as well. Just to make sure that shadow is good. If your line gets messy on you, you just go back with your burnt sienna. If you're not loving the line and you're like, oh, that didn't quite go, go back with your burnt sienna. And then just leave the black line in there and you'll find that those kind of work together. So see how that black line creates that sense of this having like being inset into the tree is what you're looking to do. And I'll show you from here. Do, 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 do. You're painting a thing and it's a good day. Worrying about anything for a minute. There we go. Now everything else is dry and I need the window to dry. And I'm going to take this time to sort of come back and, you know, re-mushroom up, as you say.
Ah, get that mushroom back in.
Get it back in a little bit. I mean, I've got it. I'm not too worried about it, but
we've got it.
Oh, we want. So adding that little mushroom, doing the same thing that we did before, just gonna sketch it back in. And we know we see a lot more of the bottom of this mushroom than anything else, right? Mm-hmm. And then the owl. So our owl, let's bring him up to about this much space. Let's make him a little more focal, right? Depending, the space he takes up is how focal he is. I'm going to make a little ellipse. And then he's got a bit of a chest. And then he's got a little bit of a belly. What's wonderful is the back of him comes off like this. Little wing. And then his feathers are doing that thing. Owls have this really cool thing that they can do where they, when they plop down on their little feet to keep their feet warm, their feet disappear under a skirt of feathers. It is super cute. I'm going to come in and make a curve line more on the left side of the oval than the right side. And then I'm going to come across here. If you've done faces with me before, you're like, wait, that works on owl faces.
That's cool.
And that's how I can make sure that the placement of his face, beak, and everything is where I want it. While I'm here, I'm going to put out a little, whoops, I'm going to watch my brush roll into yellow ochre and rinse it out. Rovetta says that the paintings are very therapeutic, and Kelly is saying she loves the sky, and Danielle's like, I entered the contest. And I'm going to say, I love my husband, and I would love some warm coffee.
Warm coffee?
Warm coffee. I'm going to put out a little bit of my magenta. I like to play with the magenta against the cad red, and the reason for that is it can kind of deepen it, and it gives me a little bit of value to play with there, which I do really, really like. Heating my coffee. Heating my coffee. All right. So Lori says, when I was a young turtle, my dog ate my brown crayon. And I needed it to color in a bunny. So then I mixed all my colors until I found brown, which was purple and yellow. And I used that blend. Lori is correct. Purple and yellow will make brown because whenever we mix complements, we neutralize them and we get either a gray or a brown, depending on if we're moving more into a red space with those complements. So that's a fun thing to play with. If you never... Sometimes it's good to sit down and just mix colors with the paints you have so you don't feel like you've got to go out and buy a bunch of paint. That's why for Acrylic April every year, we start that out with the color chart and we recommend the color chart because once you do the color chart, you know what your paint will do. If you'd like to make your own, that is a video that I have and it's free to do and I even have a printout for it so you don't have to draw all the lines. But it's so worth it because You take the paint you have before you go buy another thing. You make color charts, you make swatches, and then you say, am I missing something? And you don't buy extra that you don't need. Amy says, for a demo of the flashy, glowy button, plus I love this fun, cute Sherpa. You mean this one? Is that the button? No, is that the button? I feel like that's the button. It's my owl button. Oh, Anne says that one of her speakers is broken and sometimes she can hear me. Hopefully you can turn on. We have enabled closed captioning wherever a platform allows us to do that. So if the platform has live closed captioning as an option, it will be there on the video and sometimes that can help.
Yeah. Okay.
Especially when there's sound problems. So I'm going to take a little bit. I've gotten clean water, and I'm going to take my Cad Red and my Quinacridone Magenta, and I'm going to mix them together. And you can see right away, because it gives you a great color. And then I'm going to get a smidge, my friends, of the Phthalo Blue.
Phthalo Blue.
I want a deep red. Now, I could have gotten Alizarin Crimson and just used that straight from the tube, but why? When I can mix the color.
I like these mushrooms.
I do too. Even don't they? Aren't they like psychedelic for deer or something?
Well, for all mammals, but reindeer particularly like them.
I thought they were poisonous to human mammals.
So mushrooms in general they're poisonous. They do. That's why you have the effect that you do. They are not like. It's not like this should be dinner. No, not at all. The magic mushrooms are magic because you survive the unpleasant portion. And this is where you start getting into spirit guides and a whole lot of thing about
that. Man.
Look, what I'm going to say is if you like the myths of Santa Claus, this is a worthwhile exploration, but be ready to be surprised.
Santa is reindeer.
And
that is true. If you are from where these myths are more common, please do share. Ali says, which is easier, painting on a table horizontal surface or an easel slanted or vertical surface? Easel. Easel, because you can see the work and you can get back from it. When you're like this, it is important that you tip your work up and look at it often. I don't, and that's how I came up with a turntable to give me another way around to make sure that I'm keeping on top of it. Leslie Needle, thank you so much. All right. And Judy Beersley. Hi, Judy. How have you been? Really likes this one. Let's come in and we're going to start with a little of our blue, phthalo blue, a little of our black. We're going to start here. And we're going to go under the stem, under our stem. We're curving around the stem. Mm-hmm. And then we're going to take a curve stroke. Now, when I'm on the right side of mushroom, mm-hmm. I'm going to curve downward and towards the right. And as I come up, I straighten my curve and convex then the other way towards the left. Willow trees, just everything that has a sort of rounded shape where there is a distinctive line to it. This is the effect that you will see taking place.
Gotcha.
This is a mix of phthalo blue and black before it's dry. I'm going to come back with a little bit of white. I will dip one drop of water, loading that into my brush, and then I'm going to come back the opposite way. Implying the curve coming back the opposite way. This is about a 2 technique process to really get the mushroom, their lungs or something, aren't they? The little
gills.
They're gills.
And they hold the spores.
Very complicated little plant, a mushroom.
That is the fruit.
Even before we got to Star Trek Discovery, mushrooms were the mycelial network.
Oh,
nerding
man.
It up. I don't care what you think. I love my shows. I do care very much what John thinks, but not about TV, and you shouldn't either. He doesn't know. He's not an expert.
I know enough.
You don't know enough. You don't know anything about TV. You don't watch it. You don't participate in it. And it's why you don't get a vote anymore.
I get no vote.
He gets no votes. He hasn't gotten a vote since The Office. You lost your privileges during The Office. I love The Office. Michael Scott forever. I actually really like the American Office, even though Ricky Gervais is amazing. I like the Michael Scott that we had here. I just enjoyed him as an actor and as a person, just watching him. You want to leave this quite dark. Right. Now, coming down the base of the mushroom, we're going to go brown and black. Kind of a switch, but it's a little different. Right?
Yeah.
And on the right side of the little mushroom, we're going to have it be a little bit darker. More, not completely. Here's a little trick. Because the light's sort of coming from behind, we'll do a little thing here where we may edge light some of it. But really, you're just wanting to make sure that you've got this here. Get into your yellow ochre. Mix it right there. So you've got the burnt umber, a little yellow ochre, a little Mars black. Let's get into our white. And that's going to give us that mushroomy fungal color. I have been mixing some fungal color for a while now. My favorite mushroom painting I ever did was the Purple Fairy. If you've not seen that one on my YouTube channel, man, you've got to check it out. She's about five parts. She's so cool. She's so cool. All right, come in here. Woo! And you can see we've started to get the shape of that mushroom, haven't we?
Yeah.
Angelica says The Office is her favorite show. I like that. I agree, man. It was just my daughter, my eldest, has rewatched it so many times. I think she's like on her sixth rewatch.
Yep. Sounds about right.
Adding a little more black just to make sure that that area is as, you know, as it can be. Now, I'm going to let all that dry. And guess what? I'm going to come back over to my window.
The window.
I'm going to get my T-square out again. Why? Because as we've already identified, straight lines, not my friend. I'm going to get some black. I'm going to make this bar. Then we'll make another bar.
And then?
Another bar.
And then?
And then? We're not watching TV. John actually watches a lot because of me, and so he knows all the, like, jokes and stuff. Ellen says she's saving this to paint later, and she loves the Archer poem. We'll say thank you, Ellen. I appreciate that. Cindy M is being supportive. Amy, I don't know what Amy says. Don't feel the way you aren't, and support it. And you supported her and heard her say that it reads all the chats after the social. She would understand when it reads later. Yeah, I do. Guys, never have anxiety when you're painting with me. If there's one space in your life that you can feel okay, let it be here, right? Like, stuff happens. I'm like, as long as you're like not coming for a chunk of my side or piece of my heart, we're good, especially with my students. I am a little hard on professional artists to act professionally. I expect professional people to be professional in my space for sure. But students, oh my gosh, they have all the squishy spot in my heart. You know, and even then, I'm always going to be respectful and understanding. Okay, I'm going to go, I'm going to make a little half circle here. And then I'm going to make a line right in the middle. These are the panes, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right here, right there, and then we're gonna try to get four little verticals going down. There we go. Just kind of getting there, right?
Yeah.
Sean says it looks beautiful. So all right, let's get a little bit of our burnt sienna. We're gonna just a couple of places, and sometimes sometimes it's nice on this one, like if you take a little orange into your Santa to get enough of a highlight. You don't want to paint out your black. You're just talking about some rusting on top of the little metal support bars. Mm-hmm. So you just want it here where you can see it. And the black lets you have enough value for it to pop. That's how you get that to pop on that window. All right. Colleen is still like getting that entry link out there, which I think is really good.
All really good.
It's all really, really, really good. I'm going to come back, and this is an interesting thing. I'm going to take a little bit of my brown, my burnt umber. I'm going to get some white into it. And I've just got my number 4 round here. And underneath this window, I'm going to create kind of like a bit of aging and weathering. Mm. We want it to still feel like wood. So that's the burnt umber and a little bit of white, my number 4 round. And I'm making pretty rough vertical marks that are uneven.
Oh, yeah.
Uneven. Liking that. And then I may even take a little bit of my blue black and I might come here and go underneath and just wiggle back and forth to create a little bit of a shading. Pull some lines down. Mm-hmm. Hopefully that should age you under the window. Rhonda Garcia says, what colors would you use to make an ocean green teal? Ultramarine, blue, phthalo, green.
Hmm. Okay.
But no time figuring that out. But that's my favorite teal, is the ultramarine blue phthalo green instead of the phthalo blue phthalo green, which makes too much of a turquoise and doesn't take you into a good teal space. And you'll find that teal is like the bomb teal. Becky Quick says, darn, I missed the beginning. I will rewatch. And when confident painted, I absolutely love it. The Art Surface strikes another win. Oh my gosh. If you guys get a chance, besides coming back for the watercolor painting tomorrow, I would love you to see it. Check out the upcoming schedule between now and about the 23rd of November. You're gonna free. The fall gorgeousness is amazing. I got one hoop fall for you. Simple Mountain one hoop gets you going into it, right? Q-tip, like how much? Palette of Q-tip. You're gonna love it. So easy. We got Fall Bridge with all the colors, amazing landscape painting. We've got another Fall River, but in the middle of all that, we have a turkey. Mm-hmm. And not like my cute cartoon turkey. I have a kid's turkey. I have that on the channel, right? But this turkey is the gorgeous feathered, shiny feathered, wild looking turkey, but isn't wild because he's super fat and cute. But it's that turkey. If you ever wanted to paint that, you've got a hunter in your family, you got anything, it's a great gift. If you're trying to get ahead on your gifts, I've also got two winter tree options. One non-Christmas tree.
Ah. Oh, yeah, that one's my favorite.
Right? It's got the pink trees, and it's not a Christmas tree because I understand not everybody does Christmas, but you might want some winter trees.
I like the Christmas tree dress.
Yes, that's for the 12 days. And then the next following week, the Christmas trees that are lit up that are Christmas. So you've got either. So if you've got a gift you've got to do, it's up there. Check out the upcoming video. You're yep. going to love them. Yeah. And then Raheel's like, did I win? Did I win? I was asleep. Did
I win? I dozed off. We have not announced yet.
All right. We're doing so good. I'm going to add a little highlight, our little highlighting in the mushrooms. Now I'm getting into my just yellow ochre. You can see I'm working that into my brush. And I get a lot of white into this. And this is a thorough mix. See how it's thoroughly mixed within my brush as well as on the palette. And then we're going to just come here on this side and roughly. I don't mind some of the great gray work that we did showing through. So you can see it's a very rough stroke. And then I'll come here. And this should be lighter than what's there. Just a few of these, right? Just a few of the gills. Mm-hmm. Like that. Just a little bit. And then I may even come in with some just white. Watch this. Create a very bright highlight right there. Just pops that mushroom. Pops it. Oh, no, right. We totally knew it was a joke. John's mother-in-law tells the exact same kind of joke. Every time we have Christmas presents, she's like, is that for me? I think that would be great for me. So I'm coming along here. I'm going to get into my cad red, just a smidge of my magenta. And we're going to come in and start to paint the top of our mushroom just a bit. I don't really need to paint under him as much. And then I'm going to do a little wiggling motion. See how I'm wiggling the brush? Mm-hmm. It's diffusing, right? And if I have too much paint on there, I can pick it up. Allows me to do another type of blending, an optical blending, because the lines are uneven and randomized. And then the dry brushing lets a lot of the paint show through that's underneath. And so that's another way that you blend in acrylic. It gives me a nice kind of warmer spot. And then I'm going to get a little of my yellow and red together. A little bit. And we're going to come right here and make sure that this part facing the window has what? A little bit of light. So way back in the time before, not even just the time before COVID, but the time before YouTube for me. In the time before, my husband had video game companies. In our first video game company, we had to make environments. And so even though I had more of a traditional art background with advertising, not everyone we could handle the environmental stuff, the lighting. And one of the big things that you can see in a game where the design artists are really on point is when they have the lighting environments correct. And you start to learn little things like, if you've got a glowing window, you better have a glowing mushroom. Because otherwise it just won't seem real. So those are important things to think about. Right? Now let's put some sort of dry grass. I'm going to add just a smidge of green, but I don't want it to be like bright spring green because it's the end of the season. Rhonda Garcia says, I was wondering if you sell your paintings. On occasion, I do. We're doing sales. We do sales on occasion with the patrons. And the problem has been that they've bought every painting before we've been able to offer them to the big community.
Yeah.
So we're going to do an event at some point where we do paintings and we sell them during like some live painting marathon where it's going to be open to everybody. We're going to do that because that's just been, we love the support. It's just we haven't been getting enough to get a painting out. I'm taking my burnt sienna into my phthalo green and it makes a very deep dark green. And around my mushroom, my friends, I'm going to make some little blades, the starts of them.
Yes.
Right, coming all around. As I want to lighten it, I lighten it with my yellow, but in the mix of green, brown, so that the grass doesn't go bright on me. Yeah, it keeps it from going bright.
Yeah.
And even if I go lots and lots and lots of yellow, it's going to stay in that army green. Another way you could get there is if you had ultramarine blue and cad yellow will give you a similar green gold. But your dry grasses in fall will be more green gold than bright green. Mm. I can always come in and add just a little bit of white. And the blades towards the window might have a little more light on them. See how we're doing?
Yep.
There we go. Now, because we are surrounded by fall leaves, and there's fall leaves everywhere, fall. Take the tap, get a little bit of your red and your yellow. And we're going to add a little fall color to the forest floor.
Little fall.
A little bit. Don't do too much because you really want the trees that are around this scene to really Tracy Dyke says, can you show the color on the palette?
Let's see.
He's going to see if he can do it. Color? He's going to see it.
Which color? Which Which color am I missing here?
I don't know. Was it the green gold over here in the top?
Maybe. I'm going to see if I can adjust that over.
Yeah. I think that was the last one. I did green gold, and then I did the reds.
This one over here. There we go. That's what it is. Just it was over there a little too far. Sorry.
That's why it's good that it's live, because you guys come in and you say to us, yo, I love it, but I can't see any of it. So if you can move the camera over.
Move it over.
That's, you know, and we love that. I'm still in my number four round, John.
You're still just on that?
I am going to do Mr. Owl Face initially in my burnt sienna and my black. Mm. Burnt sienna and my black. And we're going to do a couple things. So I've got to, I want to keep my placement of a lot of stuff as I'm going. And I need a dark base. You'll notice that I'm flicking the brush and kind of implying the feathers, even though I'm going to have to come back with a very light color to even see those feathers. However, sometimes having a dark value underneath helps. His little feather skirt, his owl feather skirt. Now, before I even go up to another part of him, I'm going to get a little of my burnt sienna into that kind of gray mix, you know, because he's got a lot of gray. Mm-hmm. And come here. While the paint's still wet, we're going to add the first layer of slightly grayed feathers. Just a little curving mark. Little curving marks. You know, I'm going to pay attention to how his little feathers fall. We still will have another layer of highlight, but this is nice to get in. This is kind of like, in a way, the underpainting. And you can see the little brush marks kind of help inform that he's got these weird little feathers.
Yeah.
Now, on his wing, I may actually have the brown be a little more to the burnt sienna. And black, and we're going to make slightly longer strokes for those feathers. Mm-hmm. And you can even have them be a little bit longer coming off of his wing. And we can come back with just a little bit of black. Maybe even those front feathers come down, adding a little bit of that in there. His beak will be right here. And the eyes will be right here. They're kind of like little sesame seed half-closed little lids. He has more in common with Baby Yoda than you can even imagine. He really does. It's like crazy. And I'm going to go ahead and get a little bit of this burnt sienna in black color here. We're going to go around. Now, it may be hard for you to see, but the difference between the black that I put there is going to help me see those eyes, the placement of them, even as I'm erasing my guidelines. Sometimes in art, having a strategy is what will get you through. And as a teacher, some of what I'm sharing is just strategies. So we still can kind of see where a little bit that is, right? You can come back in with your black now. It's nice to have a little bit on that center line of his head. And then you definitely want to make sure that you've got almost a black kind of coming around under the face feathers. Even as you're adding highlights, you'll want that. His face will have a lot more kind of white into it, the white brown. You know, and I can get into my burnt umber here and just get that white brown, this creamy little owl. He's like maybe going snowy. Mm. And you're going to want to start to define the little eye circle. I like painting little owls. They're a lot of fun to paint. I might have done a few on the channel. Mm. Now here, coming up over the beak, you would want those feathers to kind of go in. Sort of how it works on this type of owl.
That's a really nice looking owl.
He is going to be such a cute little owl. The trick at the eye, let me see if I can get enough. I got to get the flow improved on my brush is what I'm doing. And I get this right on the toe. And that's how you get his little closed lid. We still have a highlight to do there, but that's how we get there. At the little feathers, right? Coming up here. Now make sure that the line is there, but it's diffused. It's feather-coated. Feather-coated lines are important.
Like 80s hair.
80s hair. And then again, the inner lid. Very sesame seed shape, if you were going to have one. Mm. I'm going to get into my yellow ochre now. I haven't rinsed my brush. Start the beak. The start, it's not a finish of it. The finish will come when we highlight and we add shadow. Now you want to make sure that around his little beak, is a bit of a shadow. It's a touch and go thing, my friends. Touch and go thing. Let's keep working on his belly. A little maybe yellow ochre, a little burnt umber, and lots of white, shall we?
Yeah.
Like lots and lots. I like to really improve the flow with a little bit of water. Fluffy. You can never go wrong with fluffy. You can see I'm just touching the brush. And the brush, so what happens, I don't know if you notice, like, during the stroke, like the tip kind of splits, and that splitting on the tip really helps create the sense of what's going on. You can see the brush directionality is helping inform his little self. There we go. Really, really on the tip. You see that there? Coming in with, and sometimes I need to like really wipe out my brush and get back because I don't want it to be full of paint and thick and not able to paint my line. Like that. How cute? So cute. Come here. Just a little bit highlighted, right? Just a little bit highlighted. That's what you're doing. Now on his wings, we're going to do some spots. And little spots. What do birds do? They camouflage themselves. Especially these boys, they're big meat eaters. They got to camouflage. They're never getting a meal. Are you loving it? Are you loving it? I'm loving it. You got this. You can do this. Now let's get a little bit of our yellow. Maybe some of our white. Making a brighter. This be delicate with. Because it's easy to let it get away from you. Want a little pop of that. And one of the tricks that I have, if I'm having like trouble getting some detail on there, this is, and I'll show you what the product is. This is a golden fluid acrylic and titanium white. It is self-leveling. It's a flowing paint. It has low drag. It's great for fine lines. It's great for details. You can't get this? Deco Americana titanium white craft paint will work. Now I gotta find my little, there it is, my monogram liner. So this is a number one monogram liner. It is an incredible detail brush. It's one of my favorites. You can see with that, that lets me get in there and create some of those little detail bits. Now, uh-oh, you know what I think's happened? Drops of water have gotten on the canvas. And they have pulled paint off. See what it did?
Yeah.
Didn't see it happen, and it did. So how do I fix that? Well, I come back and I just repair everything by hand. I'm going to use my little brush here. Don't cry. I'm not going to worry. And come back. Put that detail back. Go back into the dark. Look at this. We go right back in. Put it back. If we lose it, we put it back. We don't freak out. We don't panic. That's the thing that happens. It caused the paint to underbind. We know what caused it, and we know how to fix it. Right? And what that is that sometimes when you're working with a detail brush, I'm just going to curve his little beak a bit. There we go. Curvy, curvy. Fred Legg says that he enjoys my technique and fun spirit. Well, thank you very much. I try to have both of those because art is fun. It is.
Yeah.
Let's take this off white we mixed earlier, which we remember was a little bit of our burnt umber, a little bit of our yellow ochre, and our titanium white. This is kind of like a mushroom white. Add some warning from the mushrooms to anyone that wants to eat it. Hey, not a good idea, friends. I'm poisonous. We're recreational for deer.
Yeah.
Right. When I get that in there, I can always come back with, oh, wait, I can even use the fluid paint with a little bit of highlight of that white. So by starting with an off-white and then coming back with a bright white, what do? It creates just enough interest in that space. And everything in your painting is really value first, then hue. Hanaki Knight says, I love your hair. I've been doing purple highlights for years. Purple hair forever.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Louisa Jane, what acrylic paints are good value in Australia? Does anyone know? Thanks. Well, for one, you guys have one of the great paint companies in Australia, Matisse, it's Matisse Derivan. Matisse Derivan is out of Australia. Something to know as an Australian artist. They do not source their ochre from indigenous people, right? Which is like a big deal locally. So they are really responsible where they get their ochres, their umbers, and their siennas from. All of them are responsibly sourced. They are a fantastic company. They have incredible paint. They have both fluid and heavy body. They have lots of mediums. They are a professional brand. Unfortunately, in the United States, for some reason, we can buy them for less money than you can in Australia. I don't really understand that, but it has something to do with a deal that Jerry's Art or Alma made. So if you want to get them in the United States, they are an amazing company. The next art company that I know is Australian-based that I like is Montmart Art. And they remind me a little bit more of Royal Talons as a company. They have a lot of variety. If you'd like to see their products and you're Australian, it's Montmart has a YouTube channel. And it's really sort of informative, not only about technique, but the types of products that they have. And they do everything from kids to professional. So Matisse, Derivan is my number one pick. Fantastic neons too. And then Montmartre for Australia. So those are things. Oh no, Amy, I love mushrooms, especially stuffed with crabs, says Mama Muff. And Sandrick says, Hozart, did you ever do a wolf painting? I think I have 3 or 4 wolf paintings. I might have 5. I sometimes like certain subjects and I visit them. I know there's wolves in the mist howling. There is a howling wolf with smoke coming up. There's one in marker. There's the Red Riding Hood wolf that's in watercolor. I feel like I have another wolf, but I am not sure. Could be a fox. All right. So look, now we're just down to the bendy trees, guys. We're just down to bendy trees. But before we start bendy trees, we got to put in some background, right? Let's come in here and I'm going to put out dioxazine purple. Dioxazine purple is a really nice color and I'm putting it right there to start with when you're doing fall colors. I'm going to take a number 4 Cambridge, which is a fan brush. I'm going to get a little of my Cad Red and my dioxazine together. And this will represent some deep leaves in what is going to be a very dense fall effect up front. So I'm tapping up and down. I'm trying to create a very diffused look. This is a hog bristle fan. If you have that, or you have the Art Sherpa fan, this is even stiffer. You'll get a good effect. If you've never used a fan brush and you want to use this technique, watch my Everything You Need to Know About Fan Brushes in 5 minutes. And if that's not enough, watch my hour deep dive into fan brushes and their technique. Yeah, that's how serious it is as a tool. So I like you guys to know. And you know, hey, like many, many people will be like, oh, I want to do some Bob Ross style stuff. How do I do it? You got to master that fan. You're an acrylic artist and you want to include some of that Bob stuff into your painting circuit. You're going to need to find a firm fan. It's a Catalyst by Princeton. That is an Art Sherpa. That is a Cambridge. You're going to have to find there's a Simply Simmons Hog that's pretty good. You have to find a good fan for acrylic paint, because what makes a good fan in acrylic paint isn't what makes a good oil brush fan. You can see how this sort of gives us a diffused background. I can come up just another layer. I'm going to add a little more red into it, not all the way there, but just don't paint out all your dark color though.
You keep switching where you're at.
Oh, I'm you know what? I could probably do this and then always be in the same place, babe. I should think about my tool a little bit more.
You managed to find the one spot
that you can't see.
Right. Like every time you're like,
that's what I do. That's the joy of me. Why you love me and you marry me. And you stay married to me because I'm always entertaining. That's why. Right. Right. Right.
Yeah.
Ashley Welch is giving a laugh. Sandrix Hozark says, oh, thank you. Michelle G says soft body paint, and I see Colleen Marie says, what a fun age to paint with. How are we doing everywhere? Oh, it's Fred Log is talking. She's 8, painting with me for 2 years on, she's a good hand. I think that's really fun to get kids into art. I think we should keep kids in art. I think we need kids in music. I think we need kids in dance. I think we need kids in theater. And I think we need kids in painting. Because those imagination activities make us, I mean, yes, you want kids to be in sciences, right? But you're a better scientist if you have an imagination. So, yeah, or a doctor, or, you know, you want a Dr. House. Dr. House has an imagination. You got to develop that imagination along with those core skills. So that's why, like, anything that is STEAM, that's science, technology, engineering, arts, and math, instead of just STEM, which is no art. Then you need the arts. I'm going to draw my painting after I just preach why I think that.
Right. So, as I'm chasing my wife around the canvas surface. Sorry about that, guys. But thank you for joining us. Thank you for hanging out. We love seeing you guys. But always so much fun to see everybody out here. And see all the chat and all you guys. I'm just over here. I'm a little distracted because I'm trying to catch it. I've got two chats to keep up with. We're doing all these things. If you're ever having trouble keeping up with that, with all the places we are on our website, if you click on the calendar, it'll show you all the things we're doing.
I'm pulling up some more water. I may need a new water update soon. So, one, I want to answer Mackenzie's question about light fastness. Mackenzie is like, what is light fastness for paint colors? Okay, in art, there is a concept called light fastness, and all that means is how long till the color fades. Things that are not light fast fade very quickly. Copic markers fade so quickly. They're dye-based. They are not forever. They will fade out in a year or so. Other colors, we have some that we think are about 75,000 years old on cave walls, are very light fast, like siennas and certain natural pigments. So paint makers, to make it easier for you as an artist, will give a rating to let you know, hey, this is a cool color, like this awesome neon orange, but it's not very light fast, so don't expect more than 5 years of vibrancy from this color before it begins to fade. That's all it means. Does that mean you shouldn't paint neon colors? Of course you should. So I'm going to tell you a trick. If you paint in neon colors, paint with Holbein. They are the most light fast of the neon paint colors. Let's start painting our fabulous tree trunk. And I'm going to begin with a little bit of my burnt umber and some of my Mars black, just as a starting spot, because it's such a nice, deep, dark, chocolatey color. I'm going to use my number 8 cat's tongue. And as we're starting the trunks, I think we've only really got about tops 30 minutes left. So it's a good time for you guys. If you're going to enter, we're going to give you 5 minutes to enter the contest. The moderators are going to throw up the links. Give you 5 minutes to enter. The answer is Passamaquoddy pink. Don't stress on that. Make sure you fill everything out. You have to be here when we call your name, and one lucky winner is going to get one of these cat's tongue brushes.
All right.
Because we get it, and we love you guys, and we want y'all to be happy. And I'm going to make a little mark here down the side. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting to do the twisty branches. Because in a sense, they're twisty, but then in another sense, it's just how you're shading it. Right. So if I do one that goes like this, but I do another that goes like that, I am giving my branches a chance to twist before I've even twisted them. Right. I'm going to come here and go like that. There's a twist, a potential twist right there. And it's about these little S curves. So you can see this one has a little S curve like this, and this one has a little S curve like that. And I can come underneath here and make another little twist. How twisty? So twisty. And so twisty. We went up a little high. That's okay. I don't mind. I can come down lower here on this twist. Back into what will be the tree trunk, which is my burnt umber and my, if I need to get a drop of water, I will. Coming around the circle. So if you can see here, it goes down, up, down, over to the side. Now this one, I may have to come and put a little more of my fan in there. We'll see. I'm going to show a little bit of the trunk. Not all the trunk, just a little bit of the trunk. And there will perhaps be a small thing. Oh, Dana, thank you for the stars. And Colleen is counting down the 5 minute countdown to enter. Listen, I'm really grateful for everybody that comes, who's part of the show, who watches the show, who shares what you did, who tells your friends, who is part of our patron group. Anybody who's here, like, oh, thank you, Luciana. I'm so, So there are certain keywords, because sometimes you get trolls that the system automatically grabs. I put it on family safe thing. So if it ever just auto grabs your thing, it's, I totally saw what you said. It was totally fine, but it just, you know. Yeah.
We got little kids.
We got little kids. And so that's why we set that up. Sometimes the people that come in with like the crazy, they're faster than we are. So I'm going to make a little upward turn and then a down. And then let's do another little kind of up swing and then a down. We're just trying to talk about the way that these little trees are going to knot together. That's all we're doing. And even though it's a very dark brush stroke, right? Super dark.
I'm gonna move the...
Super dark brush stroke. Even though that's true, the directionality of the way that you stroke that out can really help it show for what it is. Then when I have that, I can even come in now and grab a little bit of my, say, my burnt sienna. And start to just brush a little bit. Or just brushing a little bit of the shapes that we're going to be seeing.
Mm-hmm.
And then on this part of the tree trunk, right? Like here, you've got a little bump there. No, maybe a little bump coming up here. We're going to want to highlight those things. You know, we're going to want them to really show and be wonderful. This one doesn't have any more twisted around it. We're going to twist this. I don't know what I was thinking when I, you know what? Sometimes I have the digital paintbrush out and I'm like, it'll be fine, whatever. Now, these two are very close in value. So what I've got to do is I've got to make sure I've got highlights on there that are serious. I'm going to get into my number four round now, and we're not going to play around anymore. We're going to get serious. We were kidding before, but now we're serious. For number. We're fine. We're going to do a very similar thing that we were doing on the other tree, right? But we're going to be a little more... kind of aged wood. So I'm going to come over and add a little of the phthalo blue to my burnt sienna. And then we'll get some white involved. And kind of see that gives us that bark gray. Let's come here. I'm going to highlight a little bit of that. And then some rough strokes. See how those are rough strokes? Rough strokes. There we go. Let's. I start to come on the inside, a little lighter values, slightly lighter values. And again, it's a little phthalo blue and burnt umber.
Mm-hmm.
It's important to twist your trunk. Your trunk needs to be twisted, my friends. Twisted trunk. And come to the front. I'm letting Colleen help some of our last minute contrast entries. And thank you for the guys' feedback. When you guys let us know where you're having trouble, it helps us, you know, come up with ways to make things work better.
Mm.
Just creating those little twists. I'm gonna twist this around too.
Twist it around.
Come on, baby, do the twist. There we go. You can kind of see how those twists go.
Yeah.
That's how we get the twist in there. Maybe we'll bring a little bit of a branch out here. We'll see. Maybe we won't. Haven't decided yet. For sure there's this one up here.
Yeah.
Dry brushing, kind of lightening it up. Going a little bit of barkiness. About a rough brush stroke, right? And about making sure that your brush is dry. It goes in pretty quick once it starts to go in. It's just about getting those first lines in. And then once you see the first lines, you can start to play with those. Play with where the highlights are, play with where the shadows are, and get a handle on your tree. And you want a handle on your tree, my friends. Because if not you, then who? So there we go. That's where we're starting out at. All right. Okay. Joyce Sawyer is mentioning that the contest link did not work on her Samsung tablet, but it did on the iPad. So one of the things to realize is that Google and every single app you have, every once in a while, have an update patch issue. Which is why sometimes your YouTube doesn't let you chat, or sometimes some function in Google doesn't work, or sometimes you don't have access to something on Facebook. It's really about the programs and things not talking to each other, and that they have to correct the misunderstanding so that all your features work. Hmm. Kind of what it is. You know what it is. I don't know why you're going, hmm. That makes me think I explained it wrong, and no, you're just fine. Letting me go. That's what that sounds like. It's like, oh, I explained it wrong. All right. I'm going to put a little of my blue sky mix up there, kind of right here.
Yeah.
And the reason is so that I can make some leaves pop through.
Cutie cute owl.
It is a cutie cute owl, isn't he? The whole thing is just a cute painting. I really like it. I'm going to have other leaves coming back. I just want to have some patches of blue because I think the little patches of blue will help inform. That these are leaves and, you know, you can see through the trees up there.
Yeah.
All right. Contest is closed. We're going to be picking a winner. Colleen will give that to John. You need to be here if you're going to win. Because the winner needs to be present. Remember to make sure you gave us your name and the name that you are here, where you're watching from. Because if you're two frogs backwards jumping here, but you're Karen at home, we need to know both things.
Yep.
Because there might be a bunch of people with your name. Like, imagine if your name was Karen Smith. Like, Cinnamon, okay, right? There's not that many of them. I'm all in a group with them. We know who they are. We know it's me. But if you have, like, a name that could be somebody else's, that's why we want both names. Okay, let's keep doing the twisty bark. I'm going to add a little of this in there and a little more white. I'm going to come here and very roughly do that little wiggling bark thing that we did. Where else did we do it? We did it on the tree there. Let's enjoy making our bark feel barky. Hmm. Just wiggling back and forth on the toe of my brush. That is the burnt umber, phthalo blue, and maybe even sometimes a little bit of the black. And we're also going to come in with some blue highlights on the tree to help it feel like there's moonlight casting on it. So there's a lot to work on. Mm. See how we're going there. A little rough mark, right? Keep them rough marks going, my friends. Keep them rough marks going. Twisting the bark, leaving these dark lines. And the dark lines create the twist in the trees. That's how you get that.
Mm.
Now, as I'm lightening the trees, I may need to darken some of the tree that is behind here so that they stand out from each other. I'm going to get a little of my black. I'm going to come here and just very lightly make sure. And this is almost like a glaze. The paint is showing through underneath. I'm not painting in an opaque manner. I'm painting in a glazing manner. Transparent. And you see how that helps that those two things be separate of each other.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to keep doing that here. We're going to help these things be separate of each other. So you come back. Sometimes it's nice to come back with a little bit of a dark line to reinforce the twists and things that you've been putting in your trees. Just keep playing with the twists. In a magic forest, the trees will twist.
Oh, wow.
We're getting there.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to maybe take a little bit of my burnt sienna and my yellow ochre together. I'm going to add a bit of a element of that. Rough though. And this is going to be the trick to make this work, is you don't want bark as rough, right?
Mm-hmm.
Get a little white into it. This is where you'll have to work, you know, as you're painting along and getting that nice rough aspect to your tree.
Yeah.
I like my bark is the barkiest part.
Is it?
You want it to be, don't you?
It's super bark.
Super barky. Rough marks, very light. Dry brushed, might come back with some burnt umber itself. You know, take a second, paint your trees. Now, I know Colleen is getting the name, so you just let me know when I need to stop so we can announce the winner.
Let's take a look here. See what... Okay, I've got a winner.
All right, I'm going to take a break then while we announce the winner. So good luck, everyone. This is our thank you from us to you. I wish everybody the best of luck, and I hope the brush finds the exact right home that needs it.
So many stars from Trey and Dana.
Thank you for the stars.
Thank you, guys. We really appreciate it. You know, it's hard for us to always catch all that stuff, but you guys, you power what we do. We make it possible. We really, really appreciate it. So thank you to all of our patrons. Really appreciate it. Okay, so today was brought to you by the giveaway of Archipa Cat's Tongue,
this brush. Not this exact brush, a new brush.
A new one. We won't give you our
used brush. That's the brush. Number 8 Cat's
All
Tongue.
All right. So the winner is Angela Lynn.
Angela Lynn. Now, what's her name on the platform she's watching?
Angela Lynn.
Okay, so it's Angela Lynn across. Angela across. Lynn, are you here?
Please be here.
We're going to give Angela Lynn, we tend to give people.
A moment. We're going to give her a moment here.
We're going to give her a moment because it can take a minute for friends to find somebody, for them to hear their name. Angela Lynn.
We're on a 30-second delay.
So we're on a 30-second delay, so we like to give everybody a minute. I'm going to keep painting. And hopefully, if you know Angela Lynn, let her know.
I see.
Angela Lynn says, OMG, I win. Angela Lynn, OMG, you totally do win.
You do. You
totally do win. So our team, Colleen, is going to reach out to you here.
You will be in
contact. Up so we can figure out. We don't want you to put your address, your home address, in a public thing. We'll
follow you up.
Privately get that. Yes. And we'll send you your cat.
We're going to come see you.
That's so exciting. I'm going to keep doing my brown.
Brown. Brown.
Oh, no, brown cow. That is exciting for Angela Lynn. We're going to do another one tomorrow during the, we're going to do another giveaway tomorrow during the watercolor.
It's a brown owl, not a brown cow.
Oh, now brown owl.
Yeah. Hoot, hoot.
Just keep painting your bark. Dark colors are where the branches are more twisted. Light colors are where they're more in light. Rough marks help it feel like bark. These are our goals. Now.
You're so fast all over the place.
I am sort of fast. We're going to take probably our yellow ochre and a little bit of white and some burnt umber and make a very, very, very light color.
Very, very.
This is our highlighting color because there's light. I'm on the edge here, on the toe of my brush, highlighting some trunk. Figure out where I mixed my highlight. Rough. The highlights are what really finalize the shape of the tree. Sometimes what I did there was just rub the paint into my brush. Light pressure. Definitely dry brushing. And you can see that those highlights are really what make it pop. So in your tree, you just want to make sure that you have a lot of color density. Right? Notice I don't have a lot of water on my brush. I'm letting the brush skip over the texture of the canvas.
Yeah.
Right. Last touch. I do want like kind of a blue highlight on some of the trunks. I'm going to take a little of my blue into my white here. A couple places we're going to just hit with some moonlight. Okay.
Yeah. Basking in the moonlight.
It's a bright moonlight, though.
It is, you know what? There's like some good bright moon nights where you can go out running around playing, and there's moon shadows.
I'm going to keep that mostly to this side because that's where you would see most of that impact.
Did you know there are moon bows?
I did not know there were moon bows, but we'll paint one now that I know that.
You can get halos around the moon. Actually, you can get a double halo.
Double halo?
On the moon, yeah.
I'm going to put out some fresh paint just because I'm getting a little hot messy for teaching. You wouldn't necessarily do this if you were painting at home, right? Because you know you might be conserving money and stuff like that. But as your instructor, I want the room to show you the mixes and the techniques, and I'm running out of what will show. I'm going to put out CAD yellow medium.
Get some fresh out there.
Gonna get some fresh out here. I'm gonna put out CAD red medium. I am gonna also put out some CAD red light. And I'm gonna put out white when I find it. And black. For the moment. Where's my.
What you looking for?
My white paint. I'm always losing my white paint. There it is. Got to put on a fresh tube.
Lots of paints.
I just got to put them. I've got them all in a bucket right now, so I'm just like doing the dig through. I got to put them on the turntable is what I should do, but I keep putting them in the other thing, so, you know.
I love how many astronomers we have with us.
Got some magenta. We have astronomers?
Mm-hmm.
And are they talking about moonbows?
They're talking about how bright Mars was and how good Jupiter is looking.
It's true. Jupiter looks good?
Yeah, it's been
We're like tippy-toeing on Jupiter, going, Jupiter, are you looking good? So for the rest of the leaves, the colors that we currently have out are cad yellow medium, cad red medium, cad red light. You could use pyro orange, quinacridone magenta. If you're using the carbon black, you can use Mars black and titanium white.
Without going on into it too much, the higher the planets are in the sky, the easier and prettier they are to see.
Is that the deal?
Well, also how far away they are relative to the Earth, to the planet. Because, you know, we orbit the sun, so that angular dynamic changes.
Trisha Woods just said 300 stars, but she said the nicest thing. Love doing imagination paintings. Our 12-year-old has an incredible imagination from before he could talk. We know that because of what he shares now. So precious to tap into our imagination for different things. It really is a gift. We all need more imagination. For sure, for sure, for sure. I'm going to take a little of my red here. I've got my Cambridge. Right? A little Cambridge going. I might tip it with a little black to get it into that brown range, right? Instead of the purple. That will help it be a little brighter. And this tapping, this diffused, we're going to be doing some very defined leaves, but we want to get some of what we have sort of used in that background, the depth of it maybe. And then I'm going to continue in that way as we paint forward. And then especially here on the floor is going to be like a lot of this. And then we got the leaves and all. We're going to take that technique we learned on the Fall Fairy watercolor to make our tiny fall leaves, and then we'll do a big focal fall leaf.
Ah, gotcha.
Isn't that nice?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to get into my orange right now. Just a little bit, and we'll go all around again. I don't want to take out my deep purple. I don't want to take out my dark colors. I just want to have a little basis for some variants before we get all of our little leaves involved, right? For those fall leaves. Now, I'm going to wipe off my brush. On the forest floor, let's get a little of our cad red orange and our cad yellow. And let's make sure a little bit of that floor, right? It has some highlights. I can keep going more into the yellow as I want more highlights. There we go. There, we've highlighted the floor. Hopefully we won't take that all out with our big leaf. Little tap there. A couple places. They might be a little highlighted. Fun to do. So, get into your number four round again.
Mm-hmm.
And the first thing that I might do is I might make sure that I'm not painting in an area that's going to be kind of a challenge for me to paint in. I'm going to take a little of my titanium white and my cad yellow. I might dry this area.
Just dry the surface. Make sure that way, when you put the stuff in, it's not going to drag paint and be nice and crisp. So you just make sure it's thoroughly dry between those two layers. Oh, just take a little. Just thoroughly, thoroughly dry it. There she goes.
So I've changed some of the placements from the digital sketch. That means I'm going to maybe change some of the placement of the leaf. Some of it may be here, but it might move some of where it is. Make a little curve line there, kind of coming up into the center. And then a longer little curve line that comes up Give me one like right here. Early one right there. All right. So that crazy prong thing happened. And what this is really about is this little leaf here. Draw in its little edge. And I'm going to dry brush it in. Doesn't have to be perfectly painted in. I've got a lot to do with it. I'm just catching that basic contour shape of it. This leaf, this focal leaf, is a big deal in the painting, I felt.
It is. See if I can move the.
You can see it coming together. I find sometimes it's helpful to build these in little stages, which is why I do a little finger technique, leaf building. But once we have this little guy in, and I mean, hey, we know that we're going to have a little stem that might curl like that. That's our focal leaf. That's not finished, as we just needed to know where it was. Sometimes you just need to know where your leaves are. I'm going to come in and I'm going to grab some of my red. Now, at first, I'm going to just tap some pieces of leaves out.
Let me see how we can get this in here so I can get you to see both the reference. They got a big reference over here.
Oh, I'm on to little leaves, though.
Oh, did you? Man. See, look at you. Oh, wrong one. Don't look at you. You disappeared. All right.
I'm up here in the corner.
Hi.
Hi, how are you?
There we go. There we go.
There we go. What I'm going to do is I'm going to turn when I go. How's that?
All right, you can just work it out. I'll work it.
I don't know.
I was trying.
I liked what you were doing.
I tried to zoom it in. I was just a little too slow.
The trick will be not to take out the little distant leaves or paint every leaf, right, in a completely defined manner. The trick is to layer what is defined and what is not. And then through that act, create the illusion of things being in focus and maybe out of focus. And your other trick will be don't paint out all your good stuff. You've had some good stuff. You don't want to get so like, oh, man. And then paint out every cool leaf that you did. Mm.
They have to be layers of leaves.
There needs to be layers of leaves. And then we define a few in, you know, more focused. And then from that definition, create the sense of tree. Yeah.
Tree.
Well, already not sucky.
Yeah, no, that's looking great.
I'm going to take a little of my, my magenta maybe in there and a little of my cat orange. And let's really get another couple values. We have to go through and get a few values. Mm.
So many of them.
So many values.
That need.
Well, yeah.
You have to do that. You just got to put the time in.
The time is required.
For leaves.
We can go pretty fast, especially on the turntable. And then when we do the few punches, it'll be like, what? Need a little more of my orange there. Get into our cad yellow. Taking that over there and I'm making a much lighter color, right? Now. It is at the tip that we will see these. cheat yourself the depth of a painting by skipping layers. Yeah, cheat yourself out of that.
The depth of layer, it's so important.
No. Let's place some leaves. Like a little orange leaf here. And I'll show you the trick for a pieced out leaf. We're gonna take one right here. Pull. You know, to the side of it. Pull. I told you in the fall fairy that technique works for all your leaves.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
There we go. And you can always come in and be like, oh, no, I want you to be a little more pointed. Right? You can, but getting that leaf in like that way, that is, you want that. In another spot, I want different colors of leaves. And a falling. I'll have to paint a few of them in. You could do an entire tree with this technique and just layer it. It would be stunning and very meditative, almost like a mandala, but there we go. See how we're getting those little fall leaves?
Yeah.
I think maybe a third.
A third?
I'll make a small one. Scale. Object relationship. Right. Oh, darn it. I just dropped my. It's okay. I have another backup. I always have a backup.
Got a backup.
I always have a backup. I'm going to get my orange here. Oh. Bigger leaves are closer. Smaller leaves are far away. Full stroke back, stroke back, stroke back, stroke back, stroke back, stem. But you can understand what I'm saying. You don't do every leaf.
Yep.
Don't paint everyone in detail. Because then what happens? You can't see it. You ever heard the expression, can't see the forest for the trees? Well, these are them trees.
Those are the trees.
You can't see. Looks pretty amazing, right?
That looks really amazing.
Okay. I'm going to take a little of this. Maybe some white into my yellow. Let's paint this leaf. Using our oranges and our yellows. It's very good if it is lighter significantly than what's around it. It shows better. Taking my orange and my red over here. And get your magenta involved too. Or have it over for the veins, but okay to use at any point. This leaf in.
Yeah.
That looks pretty good. The start of something there.
I like that leaf.
What does red and black make again? Brown.
Does it make brown?
Yes, red and black still make brown. Make a dark brown, more black, light brown, more red. But in this particular case, I want a very, very dark brown. I want it to really show across this portion of the
very, very dark painting. Brown.
Now, it's not really going to show until I put the highlights on it. Highlights will make it, but you can't get the highlights going unless you have the dark value. Coming on the back of that leaf, the inside there, a little bit of the inside there. That's how we're going to get that. Rinse out, rinse out, rinse out, rinse out. My red, my magenta, my quinacridone magenta, and my red come together. Need to darken it. You can always add black to it. I'm going to come in here and make some veins. Some veins going on those leaves, right? Now, a trick that I'll do is I'm going to really thin out. Now, you can use the fluid white, but I don't have any out, so I'll just use my white and just drop some water into it. So, see, that's the way to make fluid white if you are not going to buy craft paint or the golden. Thoroughly mixed, yeah. Very light. Wipe off with my... See how those little highlights really make a big pop?
Yeah.
Also, this definition, this Christmas of line, does another very important thing. It pulls this leaf closer to you, the viewer. Do you want that pulled closer to you? Now, on the stem, I'm going to maybe be a little more yellow, but still quite light. Along the front of the stem. Out by lightening up that stem and then just pulling back a little bit of rough. Okay. Makes that stem appear for you, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Guys.
Wow.
Look at what we did. We
That's
did
pretty.
This.
That's
we
just poppy.
Did it.
You did it.
We did it. You we painted. Did it. We painted this painting. Yes, we did it. We did it. Gonna get my monogram liner out to sign it. To sign it. Gonna sign me this painting. You grab my little monogram liner, number one.
All right.
Come right here.
Make it so.
I is going to. There you go, guys.
Wow.
You can do anything. Anything. Oh, you know what? I'm sorry. I have
what?
One thing I have to do.
What
I know I signed
do?
It, but.
It's okay. What you gonna do? You can do more. Gonna give him some highlights.
Yeah, I did that in the digital. It made a big difference, and I almost forgot.
I didn't want to backseat.
No, no.
Comment.
We all know that sometimes I sign before I finished.
Yeah, I like the highlights that you put on and make him glowy from behind.
Needs his little highlights to glow.
It does. I'm glad you're adding.
If he doesn't have his highlights, he doesn't pop as much, so he needs them.
There you go.
Otherwise, how would we know he's backlit?
How would we know?
I guess while I'm here. See, this is what happens to me.
Is it?
Mm-hmm.
What happens?
Get to painting and then I'm like, no. I could do this little thing and then it would be just like, huh?
He's sleeping.
Well, no, he's sleeping. For sure, he's sleeping. This will be small enough. There we go. And he's backlit. Sorry, guys. Sometimes you just got to backlit the thing. Huh. Got to do it. All right. We're there. Shall we zoom out and see what we got?
All right.
Elise Thompson says, watching you is so relaxing, Cinnamon. Thank you. I'm very, very glad it is. We all need. Yeah, the owl is asleep. You could give him lashes if you wanted. I think what it is, the reason he's not reading is asleep, is like, let me see if I can get that where it reads a little more as asleep. Sometimes you got to play with it so things visually read what they are. Hmm. And you don't want it to look like his eyes are open and he has some sort of weird, crazy pupilless eyes. There we go. You see him asleep now?
Yeah.
Sleepy, sleepy. He's a sleepy owl. He's sleeping. He's a sleeping. Be good to yourselves. Be good to each other. And I want to see you at Anisa really soon, which is actually tomorrow at 1 p.m. Central. No, 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for the watercolor.
Mm.
And another giveaway. Bye.